So that's interesting, but very limited right now. So what I want to do is remove some limitations. So I'm going to move on to my next step. And in this step, we're introducing Entity Framework Core. Now I'm using this for two reasons. One is it's probably one of the fastest, easiest ways I can get from this application to a actual working database. And two is because it works very nicely with GraphQL. So I've got a Cedar application. This will actually go out and grab the RSS feeds from the blogs and populate them and load it to the database. But how does the database work? I just want to show that I didn't change my blog class. I did not change my post class. Those are remaining the same. But I've got this blog's context. A blog's context is the way that you tell Entity Framework Core that you're interested in doing something with a domain class. So here I'm telling it, out of all the classes, I've got a program class, a query class, a Cedar class. I'm just interested in persisting blogs and posts to the database. So I'm exposing those. I'm telling it how they relate. So every blog has multiple posts, but posts only have one blog. So it's just describing the relationship. That is pretty much all I need to establish an API to a database.
And all of that is pretty core, no pun intended, EF core code. Like there's like if you were going to be doing anything with EF core, that's pretty much like, you know, EF core 101 syntax of here's my DB set for posts, here's my DB set for blogs, and then here's the relationship between them.
You got it.
Okay.
So am I?
See, I do remember some entity framework.
You do. So I'm still adding the same query type. Here I'm adding the context to dependency injection, so it's available elsewhere. And I'm telling it to use SQLite. So that's one of the features of Entity Framework Core, is that we have different database providers. It'll work with SQL Server, with in-memory, with Azure Cosmos DB. And you can use that same context with different databases. So we actually have some customers who might use the same DB context and fan out to a SQL database and a Cosmos DB database. So here I'm telling it to use SQLite. I'm also using our simple logging to log database commands so we can see what happens with the database as we use this.
And that's doing a bit of dependency injection. So it's basically telling your ASP.NET Core application, hey, this is where my database is. And so if you were going to go to production with this, you'd be telling it to use SQL Server or MySQL or whatever database it is that you might be using.
You got it.
Okay.
And the other thing that does for us is we can now update this, and instead of hard coding the results, I'm basically injecting the context that I just configured. And that context exposes the entities as queryables. So this is the only code it takes to now glue GraphQL to Entity Framework Core.
Okay. So what's going to happen here then is now when I write my GraphQL command, I'm going to start that over again, make sure I'm saying this correctly. I'm going to write my GraphQL command. I'm going to send that up to the server, which is running ASP.NET Core. That's then going to intercept that. It's going to send that into the GraphQL service, hot chocolate in this case, which is then going to be able to use EF Core. So it's going to translate that into a link query for EF Core. EF Core is then going to translate that link into the SQLite command and go get the data. And then it's, you know, basically just undoing that stack to send it back out the door.
That is the theory.
Perfect.
Let's see how the theory holds up. All right. So we're going to go back to Banana Cake Pop. And I'm just going to use the same query, and I'm just going to rerun it. And what you'll see is these posts came back as null. So I'm going to address that in a second. But let me back up on blogs, and let me put name and URL up here near the top. Actually don't need the commas. So I'm going to run that. You can see we indeed are getting logs. I got developer for life, and someone named Geek Trainer has this geektrainer.dev blog.
Don't know who that is.
So it's getting that, but the posts are coming back as null. Why is that? Well, let's pop back over and look at our SQL that's being generated. Don't you hate that when you're tabbing and you overshoot?
Yes.
So what it's doing is it's selecting ID, name, URL from blogs B. I didn't even ask for the ID. So it's clearly just grabbing every field, and it's not even joining to post. And this is because out of the box, Hot Chocolate just knows to ask EF Core a question. It doesn't know how to take all of my parameters and turn them into an expression tree and pass them off to EF Core to then translate into SQL. To do that requires one more step, and this is one that I hope you appreciate the work involved with this.
I want to highlight here the part that he mentioned there is what's happening is it's still grabbing every column, so it's not doing that full translation. So if you were to leave it like this, let's say I just wanted like the name or something, what would happen is the data would come out of the database into the server, like all of it, and now the server would then wind up trimming it before it sent it back to the client, which, okay, fine, that gets you part of the way of limiting the data, but now you're still getting data out of the database that you didn't need, that we really want to make sure that we're doing it fully from front to back there, where we're just getting the data back that we want.
Right. So what I did is I added two things. I added this use projection attribute onto my method, and in the startup, I added projections.
Okay.
So what I'm opting into, what projections does is projections tells Hot Chocolate to take the structure of your GraphQL query and turn that into an expression tree. So now it's doing all the work of the queryable. So this is not specific to Entity Framework Core. If you're using something else that also recognizes link queries, it'll work equally as well with that. But with that little tweak, so that we're telling it, yes, we've got something that can deal with expression trees. I'm going to refresh this. And boom. We get data. And if we look at our SQL, you can see we've got SQL that's selecting just the data that we're interested in.
That's cool. So I want to sort of go back and try and unpack this just to highlight the coolness of all of this. So what we're looking to have happen is my GraphQL gets translated into link, then that link is going to get translated into the SQL. So originally what was happening was the GraphQL wasn't doing that full translation into link. So as a result, when it went back to my database, it was just go get everything, which is not really what we wanted. We only want specific items here. So by adding in that add projections, now my GraphQL is being properly translated into link, and then my link is being properly translated into SQL.
Correct.